Good morning, students. Welcome to Panda sir's virtual class on economics, 12th economics, and we are discussing macroeconomics here. And all of you know that macroeconomics deals with the entire economy as a whole. The problem, the economic problem of the entire economy as a whole. And today we are going to start our second chapter, which is national income. Accounting. So, what is national income and how it is accounted, how it is calculated, that will be understanding after finishing this chapter. So, in order to understand better what is national income and how it is calculated, we need to understand first some basic terms, and one by one we will discuss the terms. And the first one is production boundary. What is production boundary? So before discussing production boundary, if we know or if we try to define the term national income, then of course there will be logical connectivity between the definition of national income and how it leads to the need of understanding what is the meaning of production boundary. So what is national income? By definition, I am not writing everything on the blackboard, because what note I am going to send or I have already sent to you, you will find all these things written very clearly in the form of notes and as question answers. That's why you go through, after listening to this lecture, you go through the notes and question answer and try to find out what we discussed in the video. And still, if you are getting any problem, then feel free to consult with me over phone or by messaging to me. So, how to define the term national income? By definition, national income is the total of values expressed in terms of money, of course, of all the final goods and services produced in the economy in one accounting year. So I repeat the definition. National income is the sum total of all the final goods and services produced in the economy in one accounting year. Here you need to notice two terms: final goods and services produced in the economy in one accounting year. That means in a duration of 360 days, what are the final goods and services we have already produced? The monetary value, the totality of the monetary value is called the national income. So we need to very clearly understand the difference between final goods and intermediate goods. So what is final good and what is intermediate good? So with the help of an example, it would be easier to understand the difference between final goods and intermediate goods. Just think, a farmer produced wheat and the farmers sold the wheat to a flour mill for grinding. So here you can see that the owner of the flour mill purchased the wheat as a raw material and he is going to add a value to it by grinding it and converting it into flour. So this is the first phase when we added a value to the basic raw material wheat. Now the flour mill owner, after grinding the flour or wheat, he sold it to the baker, and the baker would further add value to it by converting it into cake or biscuit. So here we see the basic raw material wheat value is added by the flour mill owner and it is again become the basic raw material for the bakery and the baker added value to flour and converted it into biscuit. So during this period the wheat, the flour, the biscuit or cake, so all these things are not finally ready for consumption by the consumer. Now the biscuit came to market or came to a shop. The consumer purchased it for his consumption and the basic thing that is wheat came out of the production boundary. So from the starting position that is wheat to the shop owner, during this entire phase the raw material was baker. So starting from the wheat up to the material came to the shop, see listen here, if the consumer purchased the biscuit for its own consumption, then only the biscuit or cake came out of the production boundary. If the individual purchased the biscuit or cake to sell it, then it is yet to come out of the production boundary. Thus, during this entire phase that is within the bracket, the goods is within production boundary and when it is ready for consumption at the end, it came out of the production boundary and became our final goods. During the production boundary, in between the production boundary, inside, it was in an intermediate state and when it is ready for consumption finally by the consumer, it came out of the production boundary. So this makes the difference between intermediate goods and final goods. And once again I remind you that while calculating the national income, we calculate the monetary value of all final goods and services produced during one accounting year and not the intermediate goods. That is main thing and you need to understand this. The difference between intermediate goods and final goods. So now I hope you have already understood what is production boundary. So our next term, because national income is the income generated to all the persons or all the production units in the country, then we need to clearly understand the difference between resident of the country, non-resident in a country and citizen of the country. Even if all three terms looks almost similar, but in economics there is quite difference among these three terms. So, what is resident? Who is a resident? Again, by definition, you will get the definition. I am not going to write it on the blackboard because in your note, you will find clearly the definition of resident of a country. Let me explain it. A person or an institution is called the resident of a nation or resident of a country if he has been living in the country for more than 2 years, and second important thing is that his economic interest lies in the country where he has been living for more than 2 years. Once again I repeat, a person is called the resident of a country if he has been living in that country for more than 2 years, first point to remember, and secondly, if his economic interest lies in that country. For example, Vivekananda went to USA. He lived there for years. But Remember here, he is not satisfying the second condition, that is his economic interest lies in that country. There was no economic interest, he had some spiritual purpose, spiritual interest in that country. So, even if he has been living in USA for more than 2 years, he would not be considered a resident in that country. Next, non-resident. So this is not the only thing that for only economic purpose people come to some other country. There are visitors who come to enjoy the scenic beauty of different countries, especially countries like India, Switzerland. Next to it, due to some medical purpose, people travel to other countries. So in such cases, those people, even if they have been living there for more than 2 years, they would not be considered as resident of that country, and they would be termed as non-resident in that country. That is NRI, non-resident Indian. They don't have any economic interest with India. And thirdly, it comes citizen. Who is a citizen? We acquire citizenship by birth. That is, if our parents belong to India or the Indians, they are Indian citizen, then automatically we are granted the citizenship of India. This is the first process. By birth, we can acquire citizenship of a country. And there is yet another process how someone can get or acquire the citizenship of another country, by legal permission. A person can seek the permission from the government or from the authority to acquire or to be granted the citizenship of that country. You can please remember the example of Adnan Sami, the versatile singer, and he was a Pakistani, and he requested Indian government for citizenship, and Indian government granted it, and now he is an Indian citizen. So this is the difference between resident of a country, non-resident of a country, and citizen of a country. Next, the third term, which is very, very important in calculation of national income, is domestic income and national income. We need to understand the difference between domestic income and national income. So, to understand the meaning of domestic income, we need to understand first what is the meaning of domestic territory. So, the entire geographical boundary of our country, including some embassies that we have already established in other countries, consulates, the combination of all these things makes our domestic territory. And any final goods produced in our domestic territory, the value of those goods is called the domestic income of a country. On the other hand, some of our residents are also living in some other country, and which is popularly called rogue, that is rest of the world. And such residents, such Indian residents who has been operating their business or who has economic interest in some other country, but they continue to be Indian resident or Indian citizen, the income generated by them, if we add it to our domestic income, then we are getting the national income. So, national income is always a larger quantity than domestic income plus NFIA, in short, which is called net foreign income from net factor income from abroad. Net factor income from abroad. Abroad means some other country, and whoever residents of India are living there and they have economic interest in those countries, and whatever income they are generating, if we add that income to our domestic income, then we will be getting our national income. So, in our next class, we'll be discussing some more basic terms related to calculation of national income. So whatever we discuss today, please go through the notes, go through the question answer and try to follow it, try to understand it. And if you are not able to understand, feel free to consult me or to ask me or to ring me. Thank you.